check, there we go. We do that song in St. Helens, man. They just can't help from just, wow. So, how's everybody doing? Yeah. Something you won't hear on CNN, the tomb is empty. Yeah. Welcome to the First Heavy Metal Church of Christ. I'm Brian Smith. If you're watching or listening for the very first time today, check us out at heavymetalchurch.com, Facebook under the First Heavy Metal Church of Christ, YouTube under Heavy Metal Church, and give it up one more time for Jacob's Dream that was there. Debut here today. Now, I don't know. I'm kind of torn here because I think, who do you think's heavier, Weapons of God or Jacob's Dream? Jake, I'm thinking Jacob's Dream might have just surpassed and become our heaviest band at Heavy Metal Church. What do you think? I hear that gothic roar, you know, and all that. That's, you guys rock, man, for real. Yeah, so we have you scheduled anymore? Or was that the... Two more times? All right. Was it good for you? Awesome, man. All right. Let's go ahead and dive on it. First of all, for those of you that are watching the recorded version and not the live version today, I've already been accused of wearing a Bengals jersey twice. And I wore this in protest today because Mama says foosball's the devil. This is an official Bobby Boucher. Yes. From the Mud Dogs. And how soon people forget that day, Bobby Boucher showed up at halftime and led the Mud Dogs to victory. Right? Yeah. Led them to victory. All right. What's up? Now you're wrong, Colonel Sanders. I love that movie, man. All right, let's go ahead and do this. This is week three of the Full Armor of God series based on Ephesians 6:10-20. I'm going to recap just a little bit. And for those that don't know, it's also the official scripture of Heavy Metal Church. Now, most people don't understand or even realize that even the name of our church has hidden meaning. Our name alone is a Trojan horse that will get us to certain events that other churches with traditional names and traditional buses could never get into. And there's nothing wrong with that. We're different fishing lures for different fish. But our name alone, you know, people automatically assume that Cannibal Corpse or Gwar, you know, is going to be handling our worship music every Sunday. And don't get me wrong, you know, we do have, today was the heaviest band we've ever had. We loved them. We get them back two more times. We do play heavy metal here, heavy metal worship. And then sometimes we have heavy metal blues and sometimes heavy metal, I don't know if we ever had contemporary, but softer rock, hard rock. We just don't do K-Love. Country. Sorry. What'd you say? Yeah, blues. We did have country here once, you know, one band or whatever. We will let, yeah. Anyway, let's not get off on a tangent. We're rock and roll, baby. But we bring in a different band every week. But, you know, there is something to our name. It is heavy metal. Armor of God. You know, it speaks volumes for a lot of different areas here. But let me go ahead and read the scripture again. Ephesians 6:10-20 reads, "Finally, be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. Put on the full armor of God so that you can take your stand against the devil's schemes for our struggle." And here's what we have to remember. You know, when people tick you off and all this kind of stuff, we are fighting against demons and principalities, and you know, God uses, I tell you what, not God, Satan uses Christians more than he does lost people to come at other Christians, man. It's really a tragedy, but Satan knows his game and well. But our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the powers of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. Therefore, put on the full armor of God so that when the day of evil comes, you may be able to stand your ground. And after you have done everything to stand, stand firm then with the belt of truth buckled around your waist, with the breastplate of righteousness in place, and with your feet fitted with the readiness that comes from the gospel of peace. In addition to all this, take up the shield of faith with which you can extinguish all the flaming arrows of the evil one. Take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God, and pray in the Spirit on all occasions with all kinds of prayers and requests. With this in mind, be alert and always keep on praying for all the Lord's people. Pray also for me that whenever I speak, words may be given to me so that I will fearlessly make known the mystery of the gospel for which I am an ambassador in chains. Pray that I may declare it fearlessly as I should. And that is our official scripture. And that's the armor of God. But that sounds awesome, doesn't it? I mean, wow, you know, the armor of God. But what does it truly mean? What does it really mean? I mean, think about it. How in the heck are you supposed to put on a military armor that you cannot see to fight an enemy that you cannot see? And it always used to baffle me. So many people say that you have to armor up. And I don't believe a lot. I think that there's a lot of Christian lingo out there. I call it Christianese. I can't stand Christianese. You know, you've got somebody that talks one way Monday through Saturday, and then for 2 hours on a Sunday, they come in, glory be his name, brother. Well, glory be his name. Hey, I'm too blessed to be stressed. Praise God. You know, and I can't stand that. And after, you know, it's like, be real. Be who you are. And that freaks lost people out. You know, you sound like a space cadet or something. Now, if you talk like that Monday through Saturday, then by all means, come on in here and Christianese yourself up. But you don't, okay? And so why be fake for 2 hours on a Sunday? Be real. I'm a Christ follower. I don't even like to say the word blessed. And oh, I'm blessed today, or he's blessed me. Of course we're blessed. Atheists are blessed in this country. All right, it's an overused generic word, just like, hey, I love you, I love you, I love you. No, all right, some people mean it, most people don't, or hey, I'll pray for you. Hey, let's get to the movie, we're running out of time. 9 times out of 10, people that say that, please help them, Lord, thank you, amen. And then gone about their lives and business. Armor up, you know, I'm depressed. Well, you gotta armor up, my marriage is failing. Well, you gotta armor up. Must not be reading your Bible enough. Must not be praying enough. Must not be armored up. What does it mean? Gotta armor it up. Can't have a chink in your armor. What does that mean? You know? And it's like, I hate to say it, but I fear most Christians have not a clue what they're saying. And again, they're caught up in the Christian ease. You know, hey, stop them. Hey, well, how do you use it? Well, you gotta armor up. Well, how do you do that? Armor up. Yeah, that's what I thought. Armor up. You know, and I believe God gave me the answer. I really do. And I don't say that. I mean, you know, people say all the time, God put this on my heart. Wrong. You know, I mean, how many times have you personally heard somebody? How many times, be honest with yourself, have you, man, this has got to be a God. And it blew up in your face because it's so easy to get something we want so bad in our heart. We feel so, it has to be from God. And then you get Christians or baby Christians or, you know, or people that come to church, you know, a couple times a year that say, you know, God put this on my heart. I was like, but that goes against God's word. Well, him and we got this thing. You ain't got no thing, chicken wing. You know, you got a thing with the devil because God would never go against his word. He would be a hypocrite. 100%. So you don't have this thing. And that's one way to figure out a false prophet or somebody that's not in sync with the Holy Spirit. Let them tell you that God gave them a vision or that they're allowed or can do something that the Bible strictly says they cannot. That's of Satan. David Koresh, how did he convince educated people? God said, I could sleep with your wife. Yeah, ask him. You know what I'm saying? It's like, woo. You know, so last Sunday we started with the belt of truth. Truth, say truth. You know, but the thing is, the world really doesn't know truth. I mean, sadly, even with Christians, there's always three sides to every story. You know, that's why if I ever speak, you know, try to be a mediator or something between friends or husband and wife, boyfriend and girlfriend or something like that, I try to get each one of them alone. And then talk, you know, because there's three sides to every story. It's your side, their side, and then the actual factual, too bad there wasn't a live camera on it recording it, because then we could see the real truth. Because sadly, we all seem to slant one way or the other, and 9 times out of 10, it's for our own gain or benefit. That's why marriage counseling is needed. That's why judges and mediators and such, because we all tend to speak a truth that makes ourselves appear to be more of a victim than the other. Well, I only did that because he did this. And well, I only cheated on him because he was always out of town working and leaving me alone. You know, I mean, it's truth, man. What is truth? In truth, moral decay sped up the decline of the Roman Empire. The Roman Empire began to trade truth for lies. They began to call good evil and evil good. And isn't it amazing that a lot of these lies have to do with, you know, like they were starting to go down that path of just insane, like sexual immorality and all that stuff, you know? And it was like the final straw. And there's been so many times that that's been true for other stories and everything in the Bible, but you know, it took 1,000 years. The Roman Empire lasted for 1,000 years. And I believe America's there now. We've hit such a moral decay. We have traded truth for lies and lies for truth. And America, we're here now. And I think we're even worse. I mean, think about it. What took the Roman Empire 1,000 years to let moral decay destroy them? And America, who wants to be first and the best at everything, we've achieved it in only 244 years. Way to go, America. I mean, the U.S. is the largest distributor of porn in the world. I said that last week. We are responsible for 60% of all the porn in the entire world. 2 out of 3 porn websites in the entire world are hosted in California. And America has 4.2 million domains containing porn. 66.7% of Americans are out of shape and overweight. I'm guilty. I got to lose this 15-pound... love fat right here. And I know what I need to do to do it, and I'm just not ready to do it. Processed foods, high fructose corn syrup, and greases are the culprits. We have sacrificed our health for quick and easy, which equals laziness. Part of the armor of God, as described by Paul, is the belt of truth. And I always used to think, what good is the belt? I used to want to, and always used to start off with the helmet first, because I thought, man, everything starts with salvation. You know, it has to, because you got to be saved and then blah, blah, blah. But no, God smacked me upside the head. What does it have to do with truth? So we're going to find out. For starters, and here's where we dove into it. The average person, and this is Christians too, and we all agreed last week that we're all nothing but a bunch of liars. Every single one of you in here, if you're a first timer, you're a liar in some way, shape, or form, and I'm going to prove it to you. So right now, I tell the truth. But it's 1 or 2 lies per day. And right now, again, you're thinking, he's wrong, not me. Well, hey, how are you doing today? I'm great. When really, you're not great. Something just happened at home, something this, something that. You're depressed about something. I remember having to watch an 11-year-old kid on life support that they think he was just pretending that he was going to go kill himself, and then he accidentally snagged himself with a rope in the closet. And by the time they found him, got him to the hospital, he was brain dead. And I had to sit there and watch and pray over him as the parents are bawling their eyes out and then walk out. And then that's on my brain and mind. I mean, this was years ago. And then, hey, Brian, how you doing? Man, I'm doing great. How you doing, dude? Yeah, really? And inside, I'm just, why? And I just want to scream. And I just want to go up and punch something, you know? But you know, Speedway, hey, oh, how you doing, sir? Hey, man, I'm doing great. How you doing? I'm great. You know, and you're not great. You're not okay. You're lying. You know, it's a lie. That's why I sometimes say, you know, I try to make a point now. Hey, Brian, how you doing? Like, well, Polk and Becky come back there. How you doing? I told you guys the truth. You know what I'm saying? I told you the truth. I didn't lie. I told you the truth. You guys are my friends. And I you know, but if I'm just passing instead of, hey, I'm doing great, I'll be like, hey, what I say? Styling, profiling, GQ Fresh, how you doing? You know, turn it into something funny. That way I'm not lying. Hey, what do you think of my world-class chili that I've been bragging about for a month? Oh my gosh, it was great, dude. You want to take some home? No, I'm good. You know? What do you think of this new tattoo? Dude, that's sick. Oh my gosh, I can't believe he paid money for that, you know? I mean, that's one thing that this world lacks is truth, and we all lie every single day. We lie to ourselves, we lie to the others, sometimes boldly, sometimes we justify it by calling white lies, but white lies are still lies, and we all do it. How can the world tell us apart when we lie as much as them? We do. We lie as much as them. If you truly were wearing the belt of truth, see, there's two parts to that belt of truth. There's cramming your brain. Excuse me. This thing's make you burp, those energy drinks. Sorry about that. I always try to contain that. But, you know, there's two facets to that. The truth of the word of God must be sewed into the fabric of our life and of our cells and brain cells. And that's truth. But then there's also, how can you be walking in the truth if we lie all the time? You know, you want to talk about a chink in your armor. We've already got one when all of us lie every day, at least once, right? Just based on the stuff I'm saying just here with these little white lies. So there's your chink. There's our defeat right there. We don't have to go past that because we're all friggin' liars. We all don't have God's word sewn in us like, well, most of us don't. We don't read our Bibles as much as we should. We don't give God, we give God our scraps after our season closes out on Netflix. And then we'll, you know, back when I was an idiot, you know, before this church, when I was, you know, trying to be the best Christian. I mean, I remember watching my show and then reading the Bible during commercials. That's stupid. Who was getting the best of my attention? Some stupid show. So there's different facets to that, but people can't handle the church. Well, I don't lie. I'm not even white lies, man. There's Christians out there that are lying about workman's comp, unemployment, Christians on disability that could work, IRS calling in sick, taking 30-minute crapper breaks every day at work. You're robbing the company. You know? I mean, it's funny, but it's the truth. It's lying. It's lying. It's deception. And there's the chink in your armor right there, right out of the starting gate. And we learned, I'm going to read it again. And Cap, I'm watching time. That's what I'm about series and stuff, because you can't just sometimes, I just want to be able to come in and pick up where I left off. But we've got first timers and stuff. So it's like people lie, man. It's like deception is all around us, on TV, at the workplace, salesmen. If you're a Christian and you are a salesman, I don't care how much money you make. If you have to lie to people every day to do your job, quit. Go find another job, but go sell a product that you don't have to lie about. How's that? You know, because you're lying. And what you're doing is, well, this is my job. This is how I put food on the table. You're lying. You've got a chink in your armor, and you have desensitized yourself to lying by justifying it for employment. It's not of God. I promise you it's not. Workplace, salesmen, friends, family, and every other category that you can think of, we are all two-faced in some way, shape, or form. The only pure truth on earth is the word of God, and that is period, period. That's the only truth. That is the only truth. The more we saturate our minds with truth, the more truth we shall speak, the more truth that we shall be, you know? And seriously, I know it's funny. I say it a couple times every year. Excuse me. You know, if you have to ask your husband or wife if these jeans make your butt look fat, the answer is yes, because you wouldn't be asking. You know you got a fat butt. It's the truth. But then, damned if you do, damned if you don't. If the hubby or the hubette tells the truth, you're screwed, because they can't handle the truth. They want to be coddled. They want to be comforted. Don't ask. Honey, do you think I'm balding? You know you're balding. You're in your 50s. Just go look at a picture of you in your 20s. Yes, your hair's thinning out. I'm still attracted to you. Either shave it bald or go to hair club for men. You know, but yes, your hair is thinning, you know, but instead, oh no, baby, you look great. Well, you do look great, but yes, your hair is thinning. Yes, I can see your scalp. Yes, that comb over. Whoever came up with the comb over? I mean, for real, you got this big, long. I've seen these. You want to start telling the truth right then and there. You want to walk up and say, dude, has anybody ever taken the time to just cut that thing, all right? But everybody's afraid of the truth. Honey, oh, I already said that one. Do you like this blouse on me? No, actually, I really don't. I mean, if you like it, that's great, but I really don't like the color. Instead of, oh yeah, that looks great. Start telling the truth. Do it in a nice, gentle way, you know? But even then, people are so desensitized to just the truth that they want to hear what they want to hear. You can be, how many have you ever really, you've told the truth before and you've done it so nice and gentle and they still get ticked and storm off? That Jack Nicholson, you can't handle the truth. You know, and Christians do this. If you spend your life telling white lies all of the time, you have allowed Satan to get the steel-toed boot in the door, and in time, your white lies start getting a little darker and darker and darker. That's how Satan works. He doesn't give you a drink through a fire hydrant. It's just a little trickle, just enough, and then he'll turn up the pressure a little bit. You know, it's just like boiling the frog. You can put the frog in a pot and just slightly turn that heat on, and the frog will not know it's on its way to death. And you'll boil it. You'll kill it in that hot water. It won't jump out. That's how Satan works. What do you think of my new tattoo? We got to stop lying. One of the reasons I lie too. I white lie. I this and that. This is convicting me as well. But I do also tell the blunt truth, and that's why I have a lot of haters. And Christians will hate you for it. Seriously, you tell them the truth, even as nice as you can be, they will hold a grudge, man. We are pathetic. We need a savior. We need the blood of Jesus Christ every single day. That's why he had to do what he did, and it was so drastic because none of us would ever make it. We are so broken and so, when this hit me that, my goodness, we want to find chinks in our armor, ding, 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 the one piece that holds all the other pieces in place, we all just admitted that we lie. There it is. So why is the belt of truth first and not the helmet of salvation? Because without believing that truth of Christ and confessing, you know, that Jesus is Lord first, there is no salvation. You have to have that truth. There's so many deceptions out there. There's so many false gods, false Christian denominations. You know, you can get duped into Mormons and Jehovah's Witness or anybody that's, you know, there's places that call themselves Christians that are saying there's many roads that leads to God. There's only one path that leads to God, and that's Jesus. That's it. I wish universalism was true. I'm just being honest. Well, hey, isn't that? No, I said I wish it was true. It's not. There's only one way to the Father. Well, why would you want, that's Jesus. Why would you want universalism to be true? Because I don't want my lost loved ones to go to hell. You know, I wish when Jesus died on the cross and rose from the dead that just wiped out all sin for everybody, didn't care what you believed, and we're just all going to have the great reset in heaven someday. But that's not the way it is. If I told you that, it's heresy because the Bible doesn't say that. Because I know the truth. I know what the Bible says, and that truth offends many. Whatever weaknesses you have, atheists suffer from depression and anxiety and all of these things, but because those are as a result of a broken, fallen world. But whatever weakness a Christian has, and it's just not any Christian. Again, I told you, if you're a Christian, that all you do is go to church on Sunday, throw a couple of bucks in the plate, read your Bible maybe once a week, twice, and do nothing else, the devil don't care about you. Go ahead, go play church every Sunday. As long as you're not threatening him, things that are going on in your life is just life. It happens to atheists. It happens to believers and non-believers alike. But if you are actively trying to apply God's word to your life, if you are actively trying to seek him with all of your heart, to know him, to grow with him, if you are actively trying to get fresh ink in the Lamb's book of life, you're a threat to the enemy, so then you've got a problem. But the thing is, if you suffer from depression, then he's going to use that against you even more. Whatever you suffer from, because the battlefield's in the mind, and that's where he's going to come at you harder than if you were just a bump on a log Christian not doing anything. If you struggle with anxiety, anger, and gossip, trust me, whether here at church or whether at your job, he's going to throw the right people at the right places, at the right time, that will cause you to have anxiety, anger, and gossip issues. You see what I'm saying? Do you see how that works? If you struggle with lust, there's always going to be something in your path to lust after. If you struggle with fits of rage, there's always going to be somebody to piss you off. Always. Welcome to Earth. And those are just a couple. There's a billion things that we all struggle with. It all takes place in the mind. That is why reading your Bible is so important. You know, we said, was it a sin? You know, some pastors will sit there, oh, it's a sin if you watch horror movies and read romance novels. You know, it's like they'll just tell you that that's wrong. But I'll say that if that is all you read and watch with your time and you only give God fragments of your time with your Bible study and prayer time, then yeah, it's wrong. But the thing is, anything, rated G movies, if that's all you spend your time doing is watching, you're saturating your mind with that and you're giving God your scraps. Anything you put before God is idolatry and it's wrong. Anything. That could be being a soccer mom or a soccer dad and your entire life is nothing but going to work, coming home, and then spending till 10 o'clock every night on the field with your kids. Are you a good parent? Great. Are you a good Christ follower? No, you are not. And you have put something else before God. You need balance. You will someday find that the more time you spend with God, the more time you saturate your mind with God, the more time you spend with seeking the truths of God, everything else will just start taking a back seat. And it will just happen naturally, and you won't even notice that you're not missing it anymore. And as far as the horror, I like horror movies, all right? It's not for everybody. Whatever, all right? If God convicts my heart on it someday, I'll quit. But if I'm shuffling through the TV and, oh, there's old Jason, you know, and then I'll go to bed and get up and start my day. It might be bad for you. I don't know. All right, here we go. Woo! All right, we made it to where I left off. Sweating. You guys all right? Was that a good, you know, like getting people caught up? I mean, okay. So, where are we at? Shut up. So we left off at, so now Paul chooses to begin describing this set of armor by talking about what? A belt. Now, why of all things a belt? He could have started with the mighty sword of the Spirit, the towering shield of faith, the shining breastplate of righteousness, anything but some measly old belt. So that begs the question, why? Why was the belt used for? What was the belt used for in the Roman army? The belt, known as the cingulum or balteus, played a crucial role in the effectiveness of a soldier's armor. It was the belt that held the scabbard, without which there would be no place to put a sword. Imagine an overzealous soldier fired up, full of PP and vinegar, and charging out into battle, but without his belt and consequently without a weapon. In addition, the Nelson Study Bible says that from the belt hung straps of leather to protect the lower body. The Matthew Henry commentary says, the belt secures all of the other pieces of our armor. Truth should cleave to us as a belt cleaves to our body. But what is truth? John 17:17 says, sanctify them by your truth. Your word is truth, or at least it should be in your life. Jesus praying to the Father gives a clear and straightforward definition of truth. God's word, the Holy Bible, Scripture, the word of truth, was given by inspiration of God, 2 Timothy 3:16. The Greek expression translated inspiration of God literally means God breathed. He actively and fully inspired the Bible to reveal his truth to us. You know, there's so much truth, and sadly, so many Christians do not know how to defend their faith. Just knowing even something simple. Well, how do you know that the Bible's real and the Torah is, or not the Torah, the Quran. You know, how do you know the Quran's not the one true word of God and the Bible is? Well, I mean, if you think about it, the Quran, I told you last week, was written in like 23 years by one author, and that's it. Nothing could be added or taken away. It was that one author. And if you do your research and know that Muhammad presented this gospel, this so-called gospel, this add-on additional gospel to the Jews, and they said, get lost, to the Christians, and they said, get lost. And that's why the Muslims hate Christians so much. And that's why, to this day, it's lasted all of that time. And, you know, there was only one author where the Bible, what did we say? It was 66 books by 44 different authors written in 1,500 years, all over so many different continents by authors that never met one another, didn't know each other, but yet somehow miraculously they were completing each other's sentences. How does one man that they called the Christ fulfill over 300 and some prophecies in the Old Testament? That's like filling the entire state of Texas up with white poker chips and then just miraculously walking in, finding a spot, reaching down and pulling out one red one. That's the odds of that being able to happen. But see, a lot of Christians don't know statistics like that. They don't know what to say when somebody asks them X, Y, and Z. Oh, it's just what I learned when at Mamaw and Papaw's church when I was growing up. So you're basing your whole life on what somebody told you. You don't have answers on why you believe what you believe and what Jesus. If you can't tell me what Jesus Christ has personally done for you and you call yourself a Christian, how could you lead anybody to Christ? You see what I'm saying? Do you see what I'm saying? We must know the truth. If you don't know God's word, then you are cutting yourself short, first of all, but you can't cherry pick what you want out of the Bible. It's God's word. It's going to offend you. It's going to make you laugh. It's going to make you cry. It's going to tick you off, but you got to believe it all. We can't follow it all. We are weak. We got to keep striving and praying for God to give us wisdom, knowledge, a heart to change, a heart to want to change. And that's what's wrong with the legalist, man. You can sit there still to this day. I cannot believe we still have churches and Christians out there that'll tell you you're going to hell for having long hair. I'm going to hell for having both my ears pierced. I'm going to hell. Skulls are evil. You know, it's like, shut up. You know, but we can't, I'm softening up on them because, again, that's what they were taught their entire lives from a child. That's all they know. So we need to learn how to forgive them, but they never took the time to read the scriptures themselves. I told you that story once. I was 12 years old, and I went to one of those churches, you know, and I'm asking, this is what my Sunday school teacher told me. And at the time, when you're 12, you're thinking, oh, this man's all wise and all this stuff. You know, you're bright-eyed looking up. And I was like, hey, brother, I just don't understand. Here, we make this big deal. We got to come in here clean-shaven. We can't even have a midday shadow on our cheeks or I can't play my saxophone up on the stage here. And we got to have that hair out of the eye, above the ear, and off the collar. But it says right there that they grabbed Jesus' beard and pulled it out by the handfuls. So how did he have a beard, and why is it a sin now? Oh, no. More than likely, what the Bible doesn't say was that he was incarcerated for a couple of days in jail before they took him to Calvary, and they didn't give him anything to shave with. You know, are you dumb? I'm just like, oh, really? Like that as a kid. And then it didn't take but a couple of years for me to say, wait a minute. An adult man, unless you have some kind of weird freakazoid gorilla disease, you know, well, I do got a fraternity brother that seems like he could grow hair pretty quick. He's Greek. But the thing is, no man can grow enough hair on his face to pull out by the handfuls in 3 days or 3 weeks, all right? You might have, pension or something. And these are this is the stupidity. And that guy was a good man, don't get me wrong. But he had been taught that his entire life to the point where you're taking all your answers from one guy that stands up there, and you don't have the mandrels to question why he's telling you that when you know for sure a man can't grow a beard that quick. You know for sure, you know. And then if you knew your Bible a little more, you'd know why in Corinthians Paul said that about women and men's hair. Had nothing to do with today. It had to do with prostitution in a shipping town. Okay, and I'll get on that some other day. But anyway, so here we go. We must know the truth. And right there, you have to have God's word sown into your heart. You have to. And then you have to quit lying. You totally have to quit lying. We are all liars. We all admitted it. His promises, his commands, his words, they are all truth. Say truth. Plain and simple. After all, the Lord of hosts has proposed, and all who will annul it, his hand is stretched out, and who will turn it back? Isaiah 14:27. If God says something, there is no force that can stop him from doing it. Amen. We can rest assured that it will be done. That's what I meant when I said that even if everybody stopped praying for Israel, their fate has already been sealed by God. So all of these people that, you know, you see it all the time, pray for Israel, pray for Israel. There's Facebook pages over it, signs, stickers, pray for Israel. You know, the campaigns are coming from a good heart, but what's going to happen with Israel is already going to happen, whether we pray for them or whatever. It's going to happen. I would rather pray for the children to be saved from pedophiles and pray for our persecuted brothers and sisters that are getting raped, beheaded, drowned, burned, and forced into Muslim sex dolls. That's you know, because we have limited time. Yes, I want my Israel, pray for Israel, but God's already set in stone what's going to happen with Israel. I want to go save the kids. I want to go save people that are being tortured and being forced into sex slavery. What does the truth have to do with the belt? 1 Thessalonians 5:21, test all things, hold fast to what is good. As Christians, we are to test all things and then hold on only to that which is good. We hold on to the truth, discarding all else. We're to be like the Bereans who search the scriptures daily to find out whether these things were so. Acts 17:11. Some of you don't read, pick your Bibles up at all. If we are not convinced that our principles and beliefs are without exception, say without exception, 100% true, how can we expect to accomplish anything? If you can't explain why the Bible says what it says and you've been a Christian for some period of time, you're failing. You need to be able to explain to somebody, hey, well, so why is your God the only God? Can you tell me why? You know, and if you don't have an answer, you blew that one chance you had to plant a seed in that person's life. How can we expect anyone to want Jesus? This is where legalistic Christians fail. They take the word of the pastor and don't search for themselves. Proverbs 3:3-4. Let not mercy and truth forsake you. Bind them around your neck. Write them on the tablet of your heart. And so find favor and high esteem in the sight of God and man. A belt encompasses the waist. Does our conviction to the truth encompass us? As the above scripture notes, truth must be bound around us and written on our hearts. Our conviction must reach beyond an outward show. Stop white lying. Stop embellishing. You cannot use your belt of truth against the enemy if you still lie all the time. And the belt holds all the other equipment. Satan already found a chink in your armor. You're already defeated. Armor up! We're already defeated. The belt used in Roman armor, as we have learned, provided a place for the soldier's sword. Our sword, the sword of the Spirit, likewise needs a sheath. Truth is vital because, like a Roman soldier's belt, it allows us to carry the sword of the Spirit and use it effectively. For 10 years now, people will come to me and let me know information that needs to be addressed. It happens time and time again. It drives me crazy. That information, they'll give me stuff that needs to be addressed with someone, but then they say, but don't say anything. Don't say anything. It happens all the time. If I don't address the problem, you know what that is called? It's gossip. What can I do with information that I can't use? Because people are afraid of the truth. Why is that? Because it can be awkward and cause massive butt chafing. Swamp ace. Ace. Swamp ace. The truth can cause swamp ace. That's a good t-shirt. I like that. The truth. Check it out, man. This is true. The truth leads to people quitting the church. For real, man. I have been blown away by the actions and slander and BS of Christians for 10.7 years. And this has happened long enough ago now that, you know, but it's like, had some people on the leadership team. I caught them, wife gossiping private information that her husband was gossiping to her that was supposed to be private to the people that it was just a mess. And I found out and I brought it to their attention. And instead of owning it, you know, I was going to step them down off of the elder and women's thing. Forgiveness is there, you know. I mean, we'll forgive, but we have to correct. That was wrong. But instead of owning it and embracing it and saying, you know, yeah, now that you put it, that yeah, we were wrong. We're sorry. Please forgive us. Instead of doing that, they got all puffed up and decided how to come up with this story that would make them look like they were in the right, and then left kicking and screaming, slandering me and once again the church and all this guy. And they were caught with their pants down, man. And these are supposed to be two good, solid Christians. And it's been years now. And you would think that after time, after smoke settles and everything, they would try to make that right. You know what I'm saying? No. And that's what I'm talking about. People can't handle the truth, especially when they're caught doing something that they thought they were justified in doing. Just like the story I told you about me having to not coddle someone the story I told you about me having to not coddle someone when they asked me if a young adult killed in a car crash went to hell if they were a Muslim and a devout Muslim and not a Christian. Well, she already knew the answer, but she wanted me to comfort her. You know, she wanted me to comfort her and say, well, you know, maybe, but it's a black and white answer. They're either saved by the blood of Jesus or they're not. Now, do I know if he was dabbling with Christianity and maybe the last nanoseconds of his life or the last couple of minutes of his life, he might have cried out to Jesus? We don't know that kind of stuff. But black and white, if somebody dies without confessing Jesus is Lord and believing in their heart that God raised him from the dead, I'm sorry, man. I don't want there to be a hell. I've got many people I do know that are going to go to hell if they don't get saved. I couldn't coddle her. She already knew the answer. So I spoke the truth as gently as I could, and I'm talking to the point of tears in my eyes. But guess what? Brian Smith is still a preacher of hate, and he's a butthole, and he left the church and slandered and calling us a church of hate, me a pastor of hate, and everybody's going to hell. I don't want anybody to go to hell, guys. Not my worst enemy. I spoke the truth and had to go through months of being painted as somebody bad. Had a situation a few months back, you know. Longtime congregants got caught running smack, you know. And not running smack, that sounds like drug. Yeah, we got drug mules here at Heavy Metal Church, y'all. No. I need a drink. Anyway, talking smack about me, and somebody run up and told me about it, and then it turned out I grabbed the bull by the horns. They ended up leaving the church, and you know, and that's not. We should be able to lovingly confront or try to get to the bottom of stuff. We should be able as Christians. I mean, how many people in here has just been forgiven so much by Jesus? I mean, so much that it's just like, you're almost embarrassed. Yeah, double hands, me too. You're almost embarrassed of how much you have been forgiven. You know what I'm saying? I am easy to forgive. I promise I don't hold grudges too long. Maybe sometimes I did, and I prayed every day for God to soften my heart, and he did. But life is too short to be carrying around a ball and chain of resentment and unforgiveness, all right? But when you are bold with people, when you speak truth to people, when you catch people with their pants down, it's awkward. It's uncomfortable, and a lot of people can't handle it, and they run. They run, and they don't want to handle and stand there and face the truth. I simply don't care anymore. I really don't. You know, I used to be real. It used to give me anxiety if I had to confront somebody. It used to give me anxiety, like, oh man, if I do this, then they're going to go and say this and this and say this. And oh no, and I don't care anymore. It feels so good. I'm again, that picture, that little boy peeing in the weeds, and it says, the less you care, the happier you are. I love that picture because it's so true. I don't care because I finally got it through this thick skull. All of these things that happen here, it's not the first time it's ever happened. It won't be the last. It's not the last church split we'll ever have. Somebody's going to pee in somebody else's Wheaties, and then they're going to get offended, and they're not going to be able to handle the truth, and people's going to gather half-truths of the situation because they don't have the man or woman jewels to come up and try to get the information from the source, so they're going to take it from sources X, Y, and Z who got it all jacked up, and now I'm the bad guy, or Pinky's the bad girl, or John's always the bad guy. But I mean, you know, you've got all of that stuff, and then people leave, they run their mouths, they go somewhere to another church and run their mouths. That's not unity in the body of Christ. There's people that I just don't like that are Christians, my brothers and sisters, but I love them. I would feed them, clothe them, and shelter them. I would not, you know, I'm not going to hurt the body of Christ. We're just going to agree to disagree and just leave it alone and focus on lost people. There's entirely too much bullcrap going on in the body of Christ. And it could be remedied just by accepting the truth, even when it hurts. Even when it hurts, the truth does hurt. Look, these situations I mentioned, they're unfortunate, you know? But now the body gets weaker because people don't handle things right. You know, misunderstanding, deception, gossip, choosing sides, half-truths mixed with pride, ego, arrogance, and the lack of the 100% truth has caused every church split we have ever had and probably all the other churches out there as well, because Satan knows God's word better than most Christians and knows how to use it against us better than most Christians know how to use God's word against him. You see what I'm saying? What other lessons can we learn from the biblical analogy of having our waist girded by the belt? Luke 12:35-37. Let your waist be girded and your lamps burning, and you yourselves be like men who wait for their master when he will return from the wedding, that when he comes and knocks, they may open to him immediately. Blessed are those servants whom the master, when he comes, will find watching. Assuredly, I say to you that he will gird himself and have them sit down to eat and will come and serve them. Christ told us to always be watching and ready for his return. And my question to you all here and to all, I always forget to say hi to our hi onliners and our family from all over the world. I love you. I'm sorry. Pinky, start putting up a big white sign that says, hey, dummy, say hi to everybody. And then point, well, don't say dummy. But as much as you'd like to. Okay. So let me ask you, Christ told us to always be watching and ready for his return. I want to ask everybody here today, everybody watching, are you really ready for his return? I want you to think about that. If Jesus Christ came down on this stage right now and said, hey guys, I just heard every one of you say you're ready for me to return. This ain't the real deal, but since you guys are so eager for me to return, I'm gonna hook you guys up first, but for your entry in heaven, I'm gonna have to go through every single one of your phones, look at all your pictures, all your texts, all your messages, go to your homes, look at your computers, your history, your movie selections, all that stuff. And I just, you know, because I really want to make sure that you are ready for me to come back and get you. But I'm sure you are, because you are like all the time, oh, come back now, Lord, make it quick. Come on and save us, Lord. So I'm here now. And that's it. Who wants to start first? Come up, let me see your phone. Wait. Are you going to be here in about an hour? Because I forgot I got to pick my taxes up, and they're getting ready to close. Man, you see what I'm saying? Are we really ready for our Creator and the Savior to come down here right now and get us? No, I'm not. Are you evangelizing enough? I mean, does anybody in here, are all your family and friends and enemies and acquaintances saved? Because if they are, I'm going to give you the keys to Heavy Metal Church. Please take my place. Come up here and show us how it's done. Yeah, no, I didn't think so. We got a lot of work to do. We got a lot of work to do out there. We got a lot of work to do in here. We got a lot of work to do in here. I am not ready for Jesus to come back right now. And I have said time and time again, no matter how bad this world gets, I will never be ready until my daughter is saved. All right? So 1 Peter 1:13. Therefore, gird up the loins of your mind, be sober, and rest your hope fully upon the grace that is to be brought to you at the revelation of Jesus Christ. Peter used an interesting analogy. Gird up the loins of your mind. Can I admit you something that is so, and Scott, I owe it. Why do I feel so self? You always sit front and center, and you're an educator, and I promise I'm not stupid, Scott. I thought the loins were right here. Okay, that's the groin. But I thought the loins were right here, and I'm thinking, dude, he used an interesting analogy. Gird up the loins of your mind, so that makes our face a butthole? Oh my gosh, that makes so much sense because we are bonehead buttholes. And I was like, wait a minute. And I Googled the loin. I felt about that big. I felt stupid, but it would be funny. Anyway, gird up the loins of your mind. This implies tucking in long garments to be ready to move quickly. The New International Version translates it as prepare your minds for action. What are the dangers of not wearing your belt? You get caught with your pants down, right? Lies, lies, and more lies. Stop lying. Be conscious. My prayer for all of us. Me too, guys. I'm not pointing at you. It's all of us. It's the church around the corner. It's the church down the street. If I preach this message to every single Christian church in America today, we're all guilty. We're all guilty. Stop lying. If you know you are an actual true, I know compulsive liars. The ones that lie all the time. And that's a mental disorder. If you are a compulsive liar and you are aware of it, you have a mental disorder. And if you know a Christian that's a compulsive liar and they don't know that they're one because they believe it, then love them enough to go tell them and grab a couple of their friends and be as nice as you can. And say, we love you, but you're a brother or a sister in Christ first. And we think you have an issue with compulsive lying. And we think you should go get checked because we love you. Romans 12:2. And do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. You keep putting junk in, you're going to get junk out. Start putting more God in. You know, remember the fish line and the knots? A lot of us have so many knots. If we were a piece of fishing line, we've got so many knots in it. The Holy Spirit is the only one that can pull those knots out. They're impossible to do without the Holy Spirit. We got to start pulling those knots out, and your knots may be you lie too much. Start being conscious about it. Ask the Lord to convict your heart every time you're about to utter a white pause for a minute. And just suck it up and tell the truth. Say it nicely. The world we live in teaches that the truth is what we make it. That's not true. That good and bad are relative, and there are no absolutes. That's what the world is teaching. Only equally valid opinions. That's a dangerous ideology right there. Listen, that's why it is just horrible now to tell someone, and again, look, I have gay friends, I have all this stuff that are like, what? When this whole thing come about, you know, it's like wrong now if you say that there's only two genders and not like 36 or something. I've got gay friends that'll be like, what the hell? You know, it's like you either got to, I was going to laugh. I didn't know if I was going to say it, but it's heavy metal church. You know, when me and my cousin were kids, you know, we're from, got Kentucky roots. She lives in Kentucky. It was a P-Tom and a P-Butt. What's he say? So you were either born with a P-Tom or a P-Butt. That's it. Now, maybe some, you guys get it, right? We're talking about P-P's and P-J-J's here, all right? You guys are like, what the P-Tom? we were 3 and 4 and 5. Gosh, I thought it was cute. Did anybody think that was cute? What about the new band? Come on, man. Can you just imagine little two cousins? Oh, P-Tom, P-Boot. Okay. It's very awkward right now, isn't it? All right. But listen, I know that there are some masculine ladies out there and some feminine dudes, but they're still dudes and ladies. You know, whatever. They're tomboys, tom girls, whatever it's called. But there's only two genders. But the Bible teaches that the truth is God's word, you know. But why? Now, this person has every right if they want to feel like, well, they identify as, man, that is their right. They're welcome here. Oh, my gosh. What have I always said? Anybody can walk in those doors. We will love the hell out of you. And even if our biggest tither, this is how much we don't care about the money here, all right? Even if our biggest tither went up and like said something bad or mean or whatever to one of our guests or somebody that wanted to become a member here and they were whatever, we'll kick them out. We will, okay? But the thing is, I can't come up here, you know, if you want to identify as a unicorn. Hey, buddy, unicorn yourself away. That's cool. But I know you're a man. And yeah. I hope you guys don't think I'm making fun of that. I'm not. This is hard for pastors and Christians to, you know, a lot of people just, you know, that's just wrong and that's blah. That's somebody's feelings and emotions and psychology. And what happened was a government that wanted to trade truth for lies. And now, no matter how nice, I'm a unicorn and you're going to accept that and call me one. No, I'm not. No. Okay. You do you and I'm going to do me, but I'm not. That's not truth. Am I making sense? The Bible teaches that truth is God's word. The good and bad are defined by him, and that there are eternal and unchangeable absolutes uninfluenced by opinions. Our country traded truth for lies when we have to play along. Now, this is no joke, and you can get in trouble if you don't play along with this. There is a guy in England that identifies, he's like a 55-year-old, 60-year-old man, and he identifies as a 6-year-old girl. And he found 2 freakazoids to adopt him, and they treat him like a 6-year-old girl that wears diapers, and still, I don't know why it's 6. Anyway, and that's not okay. I don't have to play that game. Now, I won't degrade that person. Who the hell am I to judge that person? I'm standing up here in my filth. Thing is, I'm covered by the blood of Jesus, and I know I make mistakes, and I am trying to better myself every day and follow God's word, and I can't play games like that. I want to love the hell out of that person, too, and show them a savior. But I can't be forced. And what? I'll go to jail. I mean, it's getting to the point where you can go to jail. A parent went to jail because they refused to call their son or daughter the new name that they wanted to be called or something like that. That's not okay. Paul wrote to the Romans telling them not to be conformed to this world. Part of that means not buying into a system of belief that says absolute truth is a myth. As Christians, we know both that there is truth and that it is absolute. You want to talk about science? I believe in science. God created science and uses it as a play toy. I believe in science. And science says there's a man and a woman. All right? But now I saw this other one where a man that identifies as a woman and has a woman that identifies as a man, and they're married, and they adopted a child. And they're doing this video, like on TV, they're being interviewed. And he which is a biological male that is now, you know, has the breast implants and all that kind of stuff. And it shows is really trying to have this baby latch on to his nipple and saying that, you know, we're having trouble breastfeeding, you think? I mean, for real. And guys, please, I'm really, you know, I know I can, I try to be funny sometimes and all that. I'm really not, I want you to see where my heart's at. Okay, that's not okay. If you want to get the change and think you're a woman, go for it. But taking it so far that you're trying to make a child latch on to your man nip, knowing that it ain't going to produce milk, and then playing along like, yeah, you know, we'll try a little while longer, and then if not, we might have to move to formula. Well, here, let me just go buy you a case and let's get it over with. Spoiler alert, you know. And that's the world. We have to play along with that? No, I don't. I'm not going to degrade that person. I'm not going to be unchristlike to that person. But I don't have to play that game because that's a lie. Am I making sense? I don't want first-timers leaving thinking, oh, man, he's a douche. He's up there hating. I don't hate anybody. How can I hate anybody when I got enough work on myself that I need to do? And if everybody took that serious, that work your own salvation out with fear and trembling, you'd have so much less time on your hands to go nitpick the wood specks in other brothers and sisters' eyes. But I'm talking about a lost world that don't know Jesus Christ, that are now starting to believe lie and call it truth. How are we supposed to reach them when now our government is for the lies? 2 Timothy. I mean, seriously, it's coming quick. Are you ready to go to jail for what you believe? Did you hear what GoFundMe did with the Canadian thing? You know how pissed off I'm getting? If I didn't work for Northridge right now and drive a bus, the motor coach would be on the... My passport's valid, Hookle. I would be taking the coach up to the border and joining my Class A brothers and sisters in blocking traffic. But then GoFundMe takes away the money, like $10 million that were raised so that they could have a paycheck. The government stepped in and said, take that money. They didn't do that for a couple of other organizations that were burning down cities a year ago. This is a true peaceful protest. People's going to rise up someday, man. We're getting pissed. Anybody else? And it's one of those deals. These are lies. These are lies. It's not a fair playing field. They've traded truth for lies, and you better be ready to go to jail for what you believe in, or you're going to be a coward sitting at home on the couch. I'm ready to go to jail. But I don't, not for something stupid. I ain't ready to meet Bubba that soon. The real Bubba, not Facebook jail Bubba. But I'm serious, man. Every day I read the news, I'm like, what is happening to... Well, I know exactly what's happening. The world's got to be completely upside down before the Antichrist can take power. We have begun down that path, folks. And if you don't believe me, just stay tuned. It's going to get crazier. 2 Timothy 2:15. Ooh, I can do this. Let's do it. Be diligent to present yourself approved to God, a worker who does not need to be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of truth. Imagine a belt with a segment missing. No matter how tiny the silver that isn't there, the belt is still useless. To do its job, it must be one continuous, unbroken piece. How do you apply that to your life? Speak truth and stop telling white lies, even if it's awkward and it hurts feelings. Now, be nice about it, as nice as you possibly can. But man, hey man, what do you think of my new car, man? Isn't this awesome? Well, you know, man, it's pretty, it's shiny, but that's just not my style of car. I don't like those smart cars. Sorry, I'm more of a Challenger, you know, something like that. But I'm happy for you. I'm glad you got your new car and you're happy with it. That's not my jam, you know? You know the smart cars. They're not really smart if you hit a semi. Anyway, until we start making, now listen, until we start making a conscious effort to tell the truth, the whole truth and nothing but the truth, you have no belt. Listen to what I'm saying. Until we start, now look, are we going to fail? Yes. But until we start making a conscious effort and becoming aware of all this lying that we're doing and trying to not do it anymore, until we become aware, make a conscious effort to tell the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, you do not have a belt, a functioning belt in your armor arsenal here. Your mental health is frail. Your pants are around your ankles, and you're getting screwed by the enemy. Today, yeah. Did he just say that in church? I bet you heard worse on whatever TV program you watched last night. This isn't church. You're the church. So if you watched something worse than what I just said right there on TV last night, how the hell can you look at me? Did he just say that in church? It's funny anyway. We're going to call Satan Bubba today because that's what he's been to us. We haven't even gotten past the first piece of armor and we have failed. Of course there's a chink in our armor. Isn't this awesome? Seriously, to realize where we just were screwing up right out of the starting gate? Imagine if we can just start making a conscious effort to tell the truth, the whole truth and nothing but the truth. And then we're going to move on to the helmet. Now imagine living a way of life you don't completely agree with. Maybe it doesn't seem like a big deal. After all, what are a couple of minor points that you're not sure about? Listen, those minor points are everything. Trying to live God's way without total belief in its 100% validity is like trying to hold your sword up with a belt that isn't continuous. Neither will work. Or trust in God and his word must be, our trust in God and his word must be solid without a break in it, or else we will quickly find ourselves without a weapon. No matter how effective the rest of our armor is, we are useless without our sword. We need to be rightly dividing the word of truth, knowing what we believe and why we believe it. So how secure is your belt? Seriously, don't lie. Truth is so important. We are surrounded by lies from the time we wake up until the time we go to bed. Ads on TV that make you think that if you are anything but a size zero, that there's something wrong with you. Satan is the father of lies. Our father is the father of truth. But yet in some way, shape, or form, we all continue to lie. Until you are aware of that, your armor is useless. It all starts today. Hold your hand up. Say, it all starts today with the truth. No, Auntie M, your potato salad sucks. Don't say that. But you could say it. You know, I'm just not, it's not appealing to me. You know, whatever. Just quit lying. We lie to ourselves and others by painting a picture to the world around us that we are 10 times tougher, 10 times badder. I walk out here sucking my gut in, pinching my butt cheeks, just like, hey, and then getting back here and, oh man, what's up? You know, we paint this false image of ourselves. It's a lie. We're painting this lie, you know, that we're 10 times tougher, badder, and more secure than we actually are, when in reality, on the inside, we are all a small crying child cowered in the corner, full of fear and insecurities, man. You know, we are all trapped under the ice of deception and lies. My prayer is that once you leave here today, you will be more aware of what's going on around you and in the world and inside of you. And in closing, I would like everyone in here, I want you to bow your heads. I'm going to read some stuff to you. I'll call you guys up here in a minute. I would like everyone here to bow your heads and close your eyes. And I want you to clear your minds for a minute. And I don't want you to think about what you're doing after service, what you're going to eat, or anything for that matter. Just clear your minds and listen to me as I read what the true definitions, these are the true definitions of truth. Please don't look at your phones. Facebook will still be there, I promise. Now listen. By faith, I put on the belt of truth. The truth about you, Father God, You are infinitely wise, strong, and loving. You are good all the time, and you have always loved me. You knew me and chose me before you even created the world. You sent your son to rescue me from darkness and death. You have made me your child and given me the privilege of sharing your love with others. The truth about you, Jesus, you are my hero. You are my hero. You have rescued me from the hand of the enemy, forgiven all of my sins, and redeemed my life. At the cross, you paid the price for all my sins, and by this you defeated Satan and abolished death. Now you are alive in me, and the devil can never separate me from you again. The truth about you, Holy Spirit, you are my helper, my counselor, and my teacher. You give me supernatural power and direct my steps. Apart from you, I can do nothing. I surrender my life to you. The truth about me, Lord, I am your child, and nothing can separate me from your love, Jesus. I live in you and you live in me. I am a new person, a lover of God who still battles sin. I battle Satan and the world every single day. I choose today to walk by faith, and I claim the victory over lying. Victory which is already mine through Christ Jesus. Lord, make us conscious of our white lies and give us the courage to boldly speak the truth in love, even if our voice shakes. We have an extraordinary freedom. How much of what we do is motivated by fear of man? Think of it. To be entirely free of false guilt, free from pressure, from false allegiances, it would be absolutely extraordinary. That is what gives Jesus the ability to say such startling, honest things to people. It is what enables him to be so scandalous in a good way. This is the secret of his ability to navigate praise and contempt. Neither success nor opposition have power over him. One day the crowds love him. The next day they are shouting for his crucifixion. Jesus is the same man, the same personality through the whole swirling story. Jesus is free from the fear of man. It is something more than integrity. Through it certainly encompasses that. No, though it certainly encompasses that. He is true to himself, true to his Father, true to what the moment most requires, true to love. In this forest of fig leaves, where you are never sure you are getting the true person, there is not one thing false about Jesus. Heavy Metal Church, stop fearing man and start speaking truth. Stop fearing awkwardness and stop fearing offending people. Start speaking truth. Fasten that belt of truth so that next week we are ready to put on the helmet of salvation. Praise team, will you come on up? And that was the message on the belt of truth. We have first-timers here today, and we're not one of those that are going to try to embarrass you, or we're not going to ask you to raise your hand, but I want everybody to bow your heads again. And I promised God a long time ago, you know, before we'd only do altar calls, when it was like a message that had to do with, you know, that opened up for an altar call. And God's like, no, Brian, some of these first timers, you never know when you'll see them again. You never know when we'll see them again. And I just can't let you leave without giving you an opportunity. So basically it's like this. So many people have come to Heavy Metal Church, and you believe everything you need to believe to be a Christ follower. You believe he walked this earth. You believe he was who he said he was. You believed he died on the cross for your sins. You believe God raised him from the dead 3 days later. You believe he's coming back again, but you've never given your heart to him. And all the answers are the same. It's, I've been told I have to quit this or jump through this or do this and change it. You don't have to change anything about your life to come to Jesus today. That is a lie from the pit of hell. Because what the enemy doesn't want you to know, it's like imagine mowing the grass out in a hot Ohio muggy day. When you come inside, you don't stop at the sink to wash your hands before you jump in the shower. You just jump in the shower. And that's what God wants for you, is to just trust him, accept his son. You don't have to change anything about your life, because the Holy Spirit then enters your heart. And as you actively seek him, he's going to actively seek you and clean you up along the way. I don't know about you, but that's a lifetime process of sanctification. And we're just here to love the hell out of you as your brother and sister in Christ. And we're in this together. We're going to love together. We're going to make mistakes together. We're going to forgive each other. We're children of God. But don't wait, because you're not guaranteed tomorrow. And it's no coincidence you're here today. And there's a whole other group of people that find their way to Heavy Metal Church, and they gave their heart to Jesus at some point in their life, and they got jaded by a bad experience with church, or a bad experience with this Christian or a group of Christians, legalist Christian. Oh, you're going to go to hell for smoking a cigarette. No, you're not. I'm sorry that happened to you, but a lot of the times, Satan is a genius at what he does. Why is it we always tend to blame God because he has some immature followers? It's not his fault. And he's not mad at you for chasing your tail in the desert all of this time. He's never left you. If you truly got saved back then, you're still saved. You're just playing around in the thorn bush, and you're not being effective for the kingdom. And that's exactly where the enemy wants you to stay. But today's your day. God's right there. He never left you. He just wants you to say, Daddy, I'm home. I'm sorry. Let's do this. We're going to say a prayer right now. And for those of you watching or listening, if you would like to be saved and have your name written in the blood of Christ, we call it fresh ink in the Lamb's Book of Life, or if you've been chasing your tail in the desert and you are just ready to be that prodigal son returning home and just picking up where you left off and rocking on with your Creator, we're going to say a prayer right now together, all of us. And if you mean this prayer, it's not just saying some words, getting your fire insurance and walking out the door. That's not real. It's when you feel the Holy Spirit right now tugging at your heart and you can't fight it, and you know what you must do right now. If that's you, say this prayer with us and be part of this misfit family. Father God, in the name of Jesus, I confess now that Jesus Christ is Lord. I believe in my heart that you raised him from the dead. Father, please forgive me for all of my sins. Please cover them all with the blood of Jesus. Please guide my steps from this day forward. I love you. Thank you for saving me. I want to speak the truth. I want to speak the truth, even if it's awkward, even if my voice shakes. I want this belt of truth. I want the chinks out of my armor, and I want to serve you to the best of my ability for the rest of the days of my life. I ask this passionately in Jesus' precious name. Amen. I'd like to thank our first-time visitors for coming today. If anybody said that prayer for the very first time, you are saved. Don't let anybody tell you anything different. You are. Satan can't do anything about it. Nobody can. That is a covenant between you and your Creator. If you made your way back from years of chasing your tail in the thorn bushes, welcome back, players, and welcome to Heavy Metal Misfits. We're now your family. And bring somebody next week. Next week we'll get on the helmet of salvation, and that's what we're going to do. We're going to keep rocking through the armor and find out where our chinks are at and how we can finally start using this armor of God. And when we say, man, we got to armor up, we're going to know what it means. All right, you guys ready? Give it up one more time for this amazing band. We'll be right back.
you. I think we got one more for you today. God bless you guys.
searching, searching for traces of birds. God bless you. Drive home safe today, okay? We love you. We're Jacob Stream. Good night.